This is How We Do, a documentary series about Black hairstyling and culture. We are CRWN Magazine, and this is how we do edges.
I think the best baby, and I'm not saying this for like a good hair, bad hair, but she has the best edges ever, is Chili.
Tiffany Jones is amazing. I love Tiffany Jones.
FKA Twigs for sure. FKA Twigs, her baby hair is just coiling down her face. It's so gorgeous.
1990s. R&B and hip hop magazines. I swear, seeing like all those posters and pulling them out, The Brat, Chili, TLC.
Princess Nokia, she rocks like the whole bruja, urban girl, big hoops, baby hairs.
One song I really like that talks about edges is Raven Lanae, The Night Song. Hair down, feeling all right, got my edges on tight, it's a party tonight.
You know, I used to have a lot of hair, like, I used to have hair down my back, and let me tell you something, I hated it.
You change your whole hairstyle when you do your baby hair. Like you can make a boring pineapple to something so extravagant or like something so beautiful just because you put a little more thought into like your baby hair.
I don't have time to be doing hair all day. Baby hairs real quick can make you look like you did something special when Lord knows you didn't.
I'm American born, but I am Haitian. I'm first generation Haitian. And in French, you call baby hair d'affance. And that would make you like, oh wow, look at d'affance. Like, it's so beautiful. She has this.
My sister just styling my baby hairs when I was younger and just my little baby face from time to time when I would see it.
My sister styled it for me when I was too young to even remember. I just remember baby pictures and like me being a little girl with my edges laid.
I've been styling my baby hairs since I was 10 years old, so going on 14 years.
The first time I laid my edges, honestly, it's when my mom was like, you know what, I'm tired of doing your hair, you gotta figure it out. And so I would wear like 2 Indian style braids, like Pocahontas, and I thought if I did my baby hairs every day that I would look decent. Mind you, all of the back of my head was matted because I never took the braids out and redid it, but that front was laid, baby, it was together.
I've seen division or just commentary on how if you have finer hair, then your edges are gonna lay a certain way, and if you have coarser hair, they're not gonna lay as slick. And to me, it's kind of disheartening at certain points, because I feel like now we're finding a new topic to discuss and a new thing to nitpick at, where it's like, oh, well, my edges aren't slick enough or my edges aren't smooth enough. And it's like, just do what works best for you. Like, honestly, find your lane, and as long as it works for you and as long as you feel comfortable, then that's really all that should matter.
When you think about baby hair, you think, oh, like, you have to look professional, so you lay your edges.
Working in corporate America, you know, you just don't want to deal with the questions all the time about your hair constantly. It can become very overwhelming. For me, I just want to be free and organic. I want to do with my hair however I feel in the morning. So when I wake up and I want my hair to look presentable, it's really for Sade. It's not really for anyone else. Like, I want to look good for myself and feel good. So we as Black women should be empowered to leave our homes and not feel like we have to live according to society's standards about how our hair should look.
A lot of girls contact me saying they love my hairstyle, but they feel like maybe their face isn't the right structure or their skin tone may not be the right color. I just say, try something new, be creative with it, and just have the confidence, and who cares what other people think about you.
I think Black culture as a whole is definitely pop culture. So it's not a surprise that everyone wants to lay their edges and have baby hair, because we are the trendsetters, and it's been something that even us, as like, I'm Caribbean, and like people before me here were doing things that I had no idea, and my family came here and I had to assimilate.
I like to see people be expressive and creative in whatever way they feel is necessary. I do think it also depends on the style that you're doing your hair as well. And hey, just like, give credit where it's due.
If you're not educated about it, then you shouldn't speak on it. So if you're not necessarily engraved in the history of how it all started and just how we take the approach at styling our hair, then you really shouldn't speak on it.
I think it's just ours to just celebrate and say like, yeah, other people really want to take on our style, but this is ours. This is our space, this is our beauty, and it doesn't matter how many people try to replicate what we do. The beautiful thing about being an African-American woman is that no one can be us.
From nation to nation, women had different styles, and each hairstyle symbolized something different. You could tell if someone was getting married, you could tell if someone was the third daughter just by how they wore their hair. There was a lot of detail that went into how women did their hair and the thought that went into it. And it kind of got interrupted when the slave trade happened, when the Middle Passage happened. So people were taken from their homes, but they also lost the resources that they originally used to take care of their hair, to nurture their hair. All of the natural creams and butters that they used, the red clay that they would put in their hair to protect it, you know, they kind of lost all of that when they went to this new land and they had nothing to do their hair with. So a lot of them just adapted and used what they did have. And so what was available to them were a lot of the times things that they used on the livestock, like combing shears for sheep and everything, which unfortunately, I mean, it worked, but unfortunately that was just more ammunition for their masters and for white people to say, yes, look, this is our livestock and their hair is like wool, and to make those kinds of comparisons. White people didn't know what they were doing and they didn't understand it and they didn't want to see it. And so they would just tell them to wear rags and bandanas. And so you saw a lot of slaves wearing head wraps just to cover their hair, just to get it out of sight. And so after slavery was over though, Black people had a lot of repairing to do from within. And part of that was assimilating to a European style of dressing and a European style of wearing your hair. And so in the late 18th, 19th century, that's when you started seeing women trying to find ways to straighten their hair, to elongate their hair, and alter the texture of their hair.
In the Haitian culture, they kind of differentiate you. The longer your hair is, the more beautiful you are, the flowier, whatever. But you never really think about it. I never really thought about it much until I actually cut all my hair off. And my family was like, what is wrong with you? Like, you look like you're a boy. Are you a lesbian?
I remember just growing up and you would walk down the street and a woman would like look you up and down. There was a lot of cattiness, a lot of jealousy.
There was always this division between like who had good hair and who didn't. Who was a mixed kid and who wasn't. And you know, being African American was always like the lowest thing you could be.
But since the new recent natural hair movement again, I feel that Black women are really joining together. Like, we're having conversations about our hair, like sitting at dinner. We're talking for like 40 minutes about like what product you're using in your hair, how are you styling your hair, what are you doing to like do protective styles. So it's really created a great sense of community, sisterhood amongst Black women. Like, even walking down the street now, I get stopped at least 4 times a week with a Black woman complimenting me on something. Oh, hey girl, your hair looks great. I love your outfit. I love those colors. I love how you put it together. Who did your hair? So I really love the fact that the natural hair movement has done that for Black women.
So the first person that I saw where it was more like intricately styled was Josephine Baker. So I just remember like the real slick swoop of the edges and just how that made, you know, the essence of her performance that much more amazing to watch. So I think just the attention to detail is what really caught my attention, finding out about her, and also just seeing how the styling of baby hairs has just transformed and kind of gone back to that.
The closest that I've ever seen to baby hair in our prior history started in the 20s with the finger waves. So you had women like Josephine Baker and Baby Esther, who was a jazz singer, who was the inspiration behind Betty Boop. It wasn't necessarily their baby hair that was swooped, but it was their entire hairline. And it was their sideburns that was swooped like around into curly cues. And that became very, very trendy, but it was like Black women who really just went that extra mile to make sure that everything was swoopy and just that like it became like very, very, very designed. And then after that, you had the war and you had women who just, that style, that whole polished look just kind of came out of fashion because it wasn't really deemed necessary. So then you had a lot of bouffant hair. But the one thing, even though the intricate swoops kind of went away, the one thing that remained the same was just having a neat hairline. Like that always remained in fashion. So when in the 50s, when women would style their hair and have these kind of like bouffant do's, the hairline was always super straight. So in the 60s, it was all Black Power movement, having a natural, straightening your hair was kind of contra to Black Power. And so you had these women who just had these like afros and weren't concerned with their hairline at all. But with that trend, you know, as it starts to taper off, then you start seeing afros with hairlines. And the most prominent woman I can think of in the 70s who had it was Thelma from Good Times. In the 70s, women started straightening their hair again and just experimenting with what they can do with their hair. You saw a lot of braids and beads, and Diana Ross and Celia Cruz actually, like, it was still keeping the Black pride, but like going a little deeper into African roots and seeing, like, drawing from that. As women started to change their name to more African names, then you saw it reflected in their hair, and it became more of a thing of like, okay, we can have our natural big, you know, statement hair, but we can also straighten our hair and we can also braid it. We can pretty much do whatever we want with that. And so going into the 80s, then it became that times 10. Women were like making their hair really big. You have Patti LaBelle, who is just like making her hair as big as possible, as stiff as possible, as angular as possible. And it takes a lot of gel and a lot of hairspray to do something like that. So again, you see, you know, her hairline slicked back as an extension into like her big spiky hair. And then you also have women like Salt-N-Pepa who are gelling their hairlines as they have their asymmetrical haircuts. And baby hair, as like people becoming really conscious of it, because it was something that we did unconsciously just to keep our hairline straight because you don't want to look like your hair's not done. But I think it became very specific and intentional in the 90s because of women like Chili from TLC and Janet Jackson with her box braids and slicking the baby hair down. I think it became more of a thing of pride.
Okay, I'm a Black woman, okay? I deserve respect.
And then also you have the emergence of hair products that are like iconic, like Let's Jam. Like that is probably the most iconic hair product packaging that I know of.
I'm old school, so I know when I was growing up back in the day, not that long ago, but back in the day, we always used toothbrushes to do our edges.
I start with wetting my hands and just pressing it on my baby hair, basically. And then I just use some gel. Like, right now I'm currently using the Style Factor Edge Booster, which is amazing.
I wet it almost every day just so I have something fresh to use.
So I at least do my edges like 3 times out of the week whenever I'm in the mood and I wanna go for like more of a polished look. So I use my Eco Styler Gel, which I feel is the holy grail for edge control. And I use my Baby Tress Edge Styler, which I absolutely love. I used to use a toothbrush, but ever since I found this product, I've been using it all the time.
So what I do is I start by like bringing out or combing out my baby hair like this, and just see what's up today, because it's every day is different.
So what I like to do is just grab a little bit of my favorite hair gel, and I'll either just dip my brush or apply a bit of the product on my fingers, and never taking too much, just a bit, and apply it directly on the areas that I want to enhance. And I usually just smooth it on, nothing too crazy, just to pretty much make them look a lot bolder. And if I want to, I'll get a little fancy and smooth them in furthermore or swoop some of the hairs out. But just framing my face the way it naturally does.
This side, that comb-like feel would be really good for like a soft wave. And then this side is to really just kind of like edge down that curl or whichever direction you're trying to go in.
I love doing the 2 buns when I want to show off my face structure. And when I want to do like a slayed makeup look, it definitely helps. Having all of my hair on my face, bringing the baby hairs out just to accentuate everything.
When you're styling your baby hair, I
think adding less product is the best because you don't want it to look too heavy.
It's pretty simple. People are like, how do you do your edges? I'm like, I do them in like 2 seconds and it's super simple and it stays down all day. Like I don't have to put a scarf on my hair or anything. I just, and then I go.